Welcome back to this walkthrough series of exam questions and technique lessons. Now it's time for question 8, so let's jump in and get started. This is the question we're reviewing in this lesson. Categram Enterprise is a business critical application and any form of outage is unacceptable. It uses EC2 instances provisioned by an auto-scaling group, connected to an application load balancer, and uses DynamoDB for data storage. The application currently uses 9 EC2 instances in 1 availability zone, and you've been asked to ensure it can continue operating with 100% capacity while coping with the failure of any 1 availability zone. Which of the following options meets the requirements in a cost-effective way, and you're asked to choose one? Now, this is a really common scenario which you will almost certainly encounter in the exam, dealing with the high availability of applications in AWS. So go ahead and pause the video, review the question yourself, and try to pick out which bits matter and which don't. Now that you've done that, let's look at what I identified and you can compare. The key to answering this style of question, which focuses on the ability of a system to recover and operate through failure, is to understand the raw values in the question. Any form of outage is unacceptable. That's the first thing that jumps out of the question text. The question tells us that the application uses 9 EC2 instances in 1 availability zone, and given no other information, you can safely assume that this is the minimum operational level for the application. Now, you'll also see that 9 instances are all in 1 availability zone, which is risky, but that's what the question states. The key part of this question which you need to understand is that the scenario requires a solution which can continue operating at 100% capacity, which is 9 EC2 instances, and it needs to do that while coping with the failure of 1 availability zone, and then it needs to do so in a cost-effective way. So there might be multiple correct answers, but you have to choose one, the most cost-effective answer. So with that being said, let's look at the answers that we have available. Now, in this particular case, there are a total of 5 answers. So why don't you go ahead and pause the video, review the answers, and try to spot the key elements of them. And then when you resume, we can step through them all together and compare what you found to what I found. At this point, I hope you've attempted to find the key points in the answers yourself, but this is what I located in the answers. Now, we know what the question wants at this point, so all we have to do with each answer is to identify the pieces which matter. So the number of instances in each availability zone, the number of availability zones, and the total number of instances. We need to pick the answer with the least number of total instances which meet the high availability requirements of the question. Now, looking at these answers, we have everything that we need because each answer tells us the number of instances and the number of availability zones. So let's step through each answer and review it based on the requirement of the question. Answer 1 proposes to increase the number of EC2 instances to 18, providing full 1-to-1 resilience. Now, this is wrong. Can you spot why? Well, it mentions nothing about changing the number of availability zones. The question says that the current instances are all in 1 availability zone, and without changing this, it stays the same. This unfortunately means if this 1 availability zone fails, then all of the instances within that availability zone also fail. This answer is the most expensive to implement. It has the highest number of EC2 instances, but it doesn't meet the question requirements, because if the 1 availability zone fails with the instances in, then the whole application fails, and that breaches the requirements in the question. Now, answer 2, this is an interesting one, because it's a wrong answer, but not in the way that you think. It's only wrong because it's not the cheapest way of delivering the desired outcome. With this solution, you will have 18 instances, 9 in each of 2 availability zones. Now, this means if 1 availability zone fails, you would still have 9 instances, meaning it meets the objective of the question, but it's not the most cost-effective answer, and we'll see why as we go through the remaining answers. Now note how the starting words of all but the top answer are the same. That's an example of word fluff, so adjust the auto-scaling group. Because it's shared in all of the bottom four answers, you can safely ignore those words if you're evaluating between those four answers. Because it's shared in all of the text, it essentially has no meaning. Now the third answer suggests that we change the auto-scaling group so it has three instances in three availability zones, so A, B and C, for a total of 9 EC2 instances. Now this is cheaper than answers 1 or 2, but does it actually meet the question requirements? If one availability zone fails, that means we only have 6 instances remaining, and since 9 is the minimum, this answer is also wrong. The last answer proposes 5 instances in availability zone A and availability zone B for a total of 10. Now this answer is not the cheapest, nor is it the most expensive, but it doesn't meet the question requirements. If one of those availability zones fail, there are only 5 instances remaining, which is below the minimum required. So again, this is another wrong answer. Now the correct answer is answer 4. This has us deploying 3 instances into 4 different availability zones, A, B, C and D, for a total of 12 instances. If one availability zone fails, then the other 3 availability zones provide 3 instances each for a total of 9 instances. And that's the minimum capacity of the application, which means that the system can continue operating. Now compare answer 4 with answer 2. Both of them work, but answer 4 does it with less instances, and so it's more cost effective, and that's why it's the correct answer. With that being said, that's everything I wanted to cover in this lesson. I hope it's been useful and given you some exposure to a different style of exam question. Go ahead and complete the lesson, and when you're ready, I look forward to you joining me in the next.